Samsung data migration. Well, let's see what we're working on. Picked up one of these. As you can see, it's a Samsung 850 EVO solid state versus the 850 Pro solid state. The memory formats are slightly different. The EVO, I want to say, is TLC, and the Pro is MLC. But either way, it's still a solid state drive. And considering how popular these are now with high performance machines, just makes sense to pick one up. So I've already got it out of the box and whatnot, but I'll open this up and we'll see what we got. So that's essentially what it comes in. Carrying case. Well, not carrying case. Q code. Then on the back, there's a little folder. Basically with the installation CD, which I happen to have installed, but I'll be taking out very shortly. And then the CD, damn it, I can't think of the, it's not a jewel case, I can't think of the name of it right now. Then also, you know, your instructions. And then a quick setup guide, which is fairly straightforward. So it's like, hey, that's what you're going to need, and then it walks you through doing it, essentially. But it's actually very straightforward. Now, the only thing that is a bit of an issue is the actual transfer itself, which you will need one of these to do. So this is a SATA cable, S-A-T-A cable. I picked this one up off Amazon for what I want to say is... Oh, Christ, I can't remember. I think like $6 or $7. It definitely wasn't very expensive, though. But this is the bag that it came in. StarTech. But it is a USB 3.0 versus a USB 2.0, so it is the high-speed connection. And it is for use for 2.5-inch hard drives versus the 3.5-inch. For the 3.5-inch, there's actually a little, like, cradle that you use, which works with that. In this case, though, because it's just a laptop hard drive, works perfectly fine. So you can see it's a very small, lightweight piece of equipment, I'll be totally honest. So if you notice, I did go with a 250 gig. I mean, I thought about a 500. But at the same time, I look at it more like a car and horsepower. So, needless to say, you can have a car with 90 horsepower, and it will probably do the job. But, obviously, there's not really going to be a whole hell of a lot left in the tank, which I would look at as being the 850 EVO 120GB. Then you have, on the opposite spectrum, the car with 1,000 horsepower, and... you're probably never going to use that. I mean, it's obviously nice to have it there, and it's, you know, it'll come in handy at some point, but you really don't need it. And that's what I was looking at in terms of the terabyte and the 500 gig. I don't really keep a whole lot of data on the computer. Usually I burn it to a CD or something like that, and as you can see, I have 116 gigabytes of data, so I didn't really see it necessary to get the 500 gig or the 1 terabyte, I just don't really have that much data. But I already ran the data migration software. You can see it's already cloned. Took roughly, I want to say, about, let's call it 2 hours, maybe? Yeah, about 2 hours. So I'll close this out. Okay, now it's telling me to install the new hard drive. Yeah, that's phenomenal. Well, let me see if I can open this back up. So it runs through something called Clonix. Samsung data migration. Oh, this is perfect. It's going to bring me right back to the beginning. All right. As you can see, it'll tell you what you're doing, and I mean, essentially, it's kind of straightforward. But once you hit start, that's when you're going to see these two options. One would be source disk, and then the other one would be target. I mean, this is very straightforward. You select your source disk, which of course would be your C drive, which would be your internal hard disk drive. And then you would be copying it over to the target, which in this case would be the D drive, which in this case would be the solid state. So as you can see, I have a stock hard drive in, which is 1 terabyte, but once you factor in formatting and whatnot, it's actually 931. Same thing goes for the solid state. It's 250, but after formatting and whatnot, it drops to about 232. Either way, once you do the clone, you pretty much just follow the instructions. Start, you run the clone. Clone takes about 2 hours, then it completes, and then it says, okay, you need to install it now. So I'm not going to do that, obviously, because I already did it. So we'll go ahead and exit out. There's also another program that you get. There it is, Samsung Magician. So the Samsung Magician is supposed to be more of a program designed to optimize the solid state. So technically speaking, I'm going to run this after. Yeah, see, it's saying it's not connected because it's obviously not installed yet. But yeah, it's pulling the information for the hard drive right now. But as you can see, it gives like performance benchmarks and whatnot, serial number, that sort of thing, how much is written. So it's actually very useful. I don't know if I can do a benchmark test on the stock hard drive. Yeah, actually I can. That's awesome. So it's reading the sequential read and write speed. I mean, granted, sequential speed isn't that important because those would be large files typically that you would be, you know, that you would be like reading or writing to. So it's not going to be as important. But you usually see these sequential speeds as like 540 or like, you know, 550 megabits per second, and it's like, oh, that's amazing. But I mean, in all honesty, you're probably not going to be moving very large files all the time, maybe every now and then. But this, needless to say, doesn't look that great. I actually changed my mind. I figured I might as well get the IOPS, which would be your input and output per second. So we have 329 for the write and 148 for the read. Figured I might as well grab that. The test in total took 2 minutes and 13 seconds, but obviously the solid state is going to be quite a bit better than that. So let me get started taking that out. So computer is off. So one thing you'll actually notice I have on is this weird bracelet. So essentially what this is an ESD bracelet. ESD stands for electrostatic discharge. So when you're dealing with hard drives or things like this, you want to make sure you're grounding yourself out and you don't set a shock to the damn thing and then you wipe out all your data. So I'm just going to ground it out on this metal pen on the table. So getting the hard drive out is actually very simple. For Lenovo. I mean, I do this for work, so I've seen probably the more complicated ones would be the iMacs, because you have to literally suction cup the face off, and then there's a bunch of screws, and then you have to carefully take off the surround plate, and then take some of the tape off some of the ribbon connectors to even get to it. So it is a pain in the ass, but at least with this, legit, there's two screws. So we got here and there. So two screws are out. I took the battery out, but alright, we should be able to if this is like the other Lenovos that I usually deal with. Yeah, this comes right off. Hello. Tremendous. As you can see, this computer is brand new, so there's not even any dust accumulation. So obviously the question that would come up would be, why swap the hard drive if it's working fine? Well, because this hard drive is actually going into my father's computer because he has a failing hard drive. So there's a nice little $7 adapter that allows you to put a 2.5-inch hard drive into a 3.5-inch space, and that's what this is going to be repurposed for. So let's see what we got. I'm just taking a quick look. So you can actually see a few key details here. That would be your wireless adapter, so that's a wireless AC, which is the new one. Needless to say, that's pretty straightforward. That's the fan. Motherboard looks good. Ribbon connectors look good. Yeah, that looks good. And then, we have our RAM. I mean, people don't understand how important memory is. I mean, that kind of controls a lot of how your computer works. Either you use cache, which would be your fastest form of memory because a piece of it is on the CPU, so it's be whatever your computer is accessing very often. And then you have RAM, which would be number two. That's random access memory, and that would be for programs that are not quite as frequently used as the ones on the cache, but you know, the computer still needs to access relatively quickly, so puts it in the RAM. Or worst case scenario, the Achilles heel in this whole thing would be the hard drive. The hard drive is by far the slowest of the three, so by upgrading it to a solid state, now your computer is still able to access those files, but it's able to access them closer to the speed of RAM. Is it the exact speed? No, but it's still a hell of a lot faster than what you get with a hard drive. So these are almost all out. So with the Lenovo, I know there's four screws that hold it in. HP, I want to say there's maybe three that hold in, and then the iMac, there's one. No, actually, no, there's no screws. There's like a, it sits in like a cradle, and then the cradle like pops out. So, right. So I can go ahead and pull this out. Oh, that one's not loose yet. All right, so she's free. All the screws are loose. So let's go ahead and pull this one up. I think I just got it. Yeah, I got it. Alright. Hello. And that is our 1 terabyte hard drive. Hello. Oh shit, it's a Samsung. I didn't even realize that. So I'm swapping it with another Samsung. Go figure. But you can look at the connection. It's a SATA connection, though. If this would focus. There we go. It's a SATA connection, so plug and play. So now I'm going to take off this cradle, basically. I'm going to transfer it over to the solid state. So as you can see, there's only four screws. It's usually four, one on each corner. So you have these two, and then those two. And this will basically go into the same cradle. All right. So if we notice, the cradle is now off that, and it is now on the Samsung. Well, Samsung number two, I should say. So you see it screws right on. Usually there's lettering or something to tell you, right side, left side. But now that that's set up, I can go ahead and... You want to line it up though first, so you have the short side on the left. Well, let me see. Technically, that would be, yeah, I'm gonna say, yeah, left.
And then the large side would be on the right. So if we look in here, you can see the SATA connection. Small ones on the left, large ones on the right. So let's go ahead and slide her in. Well, you don't want to slide it in without actually plugging it in. That would be a failure. There it is. Come on. Just gonna pull it forward. All right, there she is, and she is in. How much better does that look? Yeah, that looks amazing. All right, so she is secured back in now. So if you notice, we have all four screws put back in. So now I'm gonna go ahead and put the cover back on. Make sure I'm not line this up right. Usually you could just put this down and then push up, slide. Oh, there it goes. There you go. So just gotta give it a little push up, and everything should line back up as it did before. Now we just need to put those two screws. One there, one there. Those are both back in. So we'll go ahead and put the battery back. Clip that in. And we'll lock it in. And that's a hard drive swap, which people pay a decent amount of money to have done, but as you can see, the computers now are built much more for accessibility. Still, I wouldn't recommend, if you've never done it before, doing it on an iMac. That's not a good time if you don't know what you're doing. That's a real bad time. Power on. Oh shit, I forgot I left the CD in. This is gonna take us to the boot manager screen. We're gonna do the boot manager from the SSD. Hello. Yeah, that time is definitely accurate too. I'm gonna put my password on. Let's see how quickly it loads. Boom. Let's open this. Yeah. Alright. So, now you see it gives us the information on our hard drive. How much we've written to it, the health of it, how much space is used, how much space is free. So, what we want to go ahead and do now, I'm going to run that same benchmark. Let's see how she does this time. So, remember before it was in the 20s. I think this might be a little better. Yeah, as you can see, it's, yeah, that's, Christ, that's incredible. The IOPS are through the roof. I think before it was like 329, it's now like 21,000, holy shit. That is a very good margin faster. Whoa. Yeah, that's quick. Let's see, now it says performance optimization. All right, if your current OS does not offer native trim support for SSDs, you can use Magician to optimize performance as needed. Performance optimization complete. Alright. And let's see if anything changes here with the optimization. Probably not. But yeah, I could tell you in advance, I am already loving the solid state. The speed is crazy, so let's see. Firmware update. It's running the latest firmware. OS optimization. Let's see what this is. Current status not configured. And we are finishing up. This took basically no time. I mean, this was legit like 10 minutes, if that. So the nice thing with the Clonix software that Samsung gives you with any of their these V-band 850 series hard drives, you get the software, the Clonix software, with it for the data migration. And in this case, I didn't even have to reinstall it. So all the, I mean, the CD and everything in here is, it's open. It's not even, shit, nice. It's not even open. But I just want to show you what this looks like once this finishes. If I can get the damn CD off the floor. I'll put this up in the meantime. But a lot of people, you know, wonder, like, oh, well, what do I have to do after, you know, I finish the migration? Really install the hard drive, that's it. That's the beauty of this software. It is so intuitive that legitimately it is a plug-and-play solution. You don't have to re-download all your applications or set your desktop and whatnot back up. You just pop the software in, install it, and then from now on, if you ever wanted to upgrade a hard drive, you run the software and boom, done. So oh, that looks so much better. 349 available gigs available now. So oh, that's tremendous. Legitimately, I had it, I think I only had like 50 gigs of space left or something. I mean, I've cleaned a lot of stuff off, but I legitimately only had like 50 gigs. And anyone knows with an SSD, the closer it gets to getting full, the worse it performs. When you start getting up to 60, 70, 80% of its maximum capacity, it's just not going to operate well. It is what it is. Just because of the way the data stores, you know, with an SSD versus a hard drive. And a hard drive, things technically never get deleted. It's just more of the, it just, the hard drive doesn't register it anymore. It doesn't actually recognize it as being there. But technically speaking, there's still shadow volumes and your data's still there, which is kind of a nice thing, because if you ever accidentally delete something, you could usually get it back. But with this, it's a little different. But either way, having this additional space is definitely going to make the dual OS setup work a hell of a lot better. So I'm going to go ahead and get this thrown in and check the load times for both systems. There we go. So I got my Ubuntu disk. I'm probably mispronouncing that, but this will be the first boot, so let's see what happens. It's probably not going to load. Yeah. So Ubuntu, I don't know how to pronounce it, but it loads through this thing called Grub, which is what gives you an option of what OS you want to load to. So let's hit exit. This takes you into like the UEFI loader, so you can pick what you want to load from. So let me see if I can load Ubuntu. Actually, I'm going to put the disk in, so I don't think this is going to work, because it's probably not going to have the same partition the way the previous one did. But because you have to set aside a separate partition for the Ubuntu system, so it's like 11, usually like 11 gigs, like between like 11 and 20 gigs, somewhere in that range. But I doubt this has the partition already, so I'll try Ubuntu. Yeah, I don't think it's going to work. Exit. Boot succeeded. CD-ROM. Oh, there we go. Let's go to try Ubuntu. I'm going to turn this light off so there's not so much reflection. Well, that's crazy. It didn't change the reflection at all. Maybe more light? Nope. Still sucks. Let's take the light down, though. There you go. That's a very good sign, Ubuntu. Christ, I can't get a good... This process usually takes a little bit here. Now, the only reason I went to try instead of install, last time I just tried to install it, it actually gave me an error. I can't remember the error off the top of my head, but it wouldn't allow me to install, so I had to go to try first and try, I don't know, for whatever reason, try works. And then after that, you can go to install. And then it will give you different options of, do you want to install over the existing OS, or do you want to install it alongside? And in this case, we're going to be installing alongside. This just takes a minute for the CD to load, though. But why am I running Ubuntu instead of just the Windows bootloader? There's a few Linux-based programs that work better than Windows. So I'd rather run them through Ubuntu versus Windows. And I'm not completely sold on Ubuntu yet, so that's why I haven't just deleted my Windows installation. And plus, I think it's kind of cool to be able to pick which OS you want to run. And considering I'm running the solid state, this should make this so much easier than if I was trying to dual boot off of a normal hard drive. I know that would definitely affect load times, even if it was a brand new hard drive. All right, that's a good sign. All right, so this just popped up a few moments ago. The time obviously is super incorrect, so don't. It's not 10:56 p.m., but. So what we're going to do is go to install Ubuntu. I know I'm mispronouncing that. This is probably going to need internet access. I'm going to plug in my Ethernet cord. Yeah, see, this is the page you'll get. Let me plug in the Ethernet real quick. Alright, so Ethernet cable is in, so let's just go in. Walk through the, oh, that's good, connection established, excellent. So let's just walk through the options quickly. English, continue. Yep. And we'll do install third-party software for graphics and Wi-Fi, hardware, flash, MP3, and other media. Now continue. It's thinking. Alright, installation type. So this is the most important thing. So you have install Ubuntu alongside Windows Boot Manager, or erase disk and install. I don't want to do that, so I'm going to install it alongside. So basically it'll run through something called GNU Grub, and essentially it'll allow you to run both OS's. You just select which one. So I'm going to allocate 100 gigabytes, if this will cooperate, which should be more than enough for this installation. Say install now. And that's perfectly okay. And it is now going to install. I'll say New York, that's fine. English, you ask. Let me fill in this stuff. Alright, and now that I've entered in my data, it's going to go to this screen about installing. And then it is going to proceed to install. So I'll let it install, and I'll come back to this. Alright, and the installation has completed, so now we get this message. Installation is finished. You can continue testing Ubuntu now, but until you restart the computer, any changes you make or documents you save will not be preserved. So, that's exactly what we're going to do, is restart. And now we're going to go through the grub manager, GNU grub, which is basically going to let us select either Ubuntu or Windows. Ubuntu. Take the CD out. Hit enter. Alright, now we get GNU grub. Perfect. So now we can select. We have Ubuntu, advanced options, Windows boot manager, and then system setup. So for right now, I just want to try to run Windows. We'll see what happens there. Booting into Windows. So let me log in. It's not that slow, but still hasn't finished either. So let's check the disk management settings. So basically, to get to that, you right click on we right click on the start and then go to disk management. This should show what we have for active partitions. There we go. So let's open that up. So we have Windows, recovery partition, and then this EFI. Now there should be a partition here as well for Ubuntu, so what we're going to do is restart, which is going to take us back to GrubLoader. And this time we are going to boot into Ubuntu. Boom! Ubuntu loads pretty quickly. Same computer, but as you can see, the OS loads way quicker for whatever reason. And then it still gives you like the commands and whatnot, so I'm going to exit out of this. Might as well install the updates. Let me see, hold on, let me think for a minute. Okay, it is a little different installing updates on here. You go into settings, about this computer, and then you'll get a little option down there that says install updates. I might as well do it now. 171. As you can see, Ubuntu has quite a different look than Windows. But Windows is still easily accessible right through here, so I still have all my normal documents and whatnot. So if I go into users, I go into my user profile, and let's try music. There's all my music. Alright, let's exit out of this though, because I think the update is done. Yeah, it is. So let's go restart now.
to the purple. And it has now restarted. Alright, so this time we're going to go into Windows. See how quickly this loads. Usually it's in a couple seconds. Alright, Windows is here. Log in. One thing I'm going to have to check is the clock. The time is still off. I mean, usually about the only thing that's going to cause that is if a time zone changes or if your CMOS battery is done. The CMOS battery literally is like one of the CR batteries, like in a watch. Well, it's bigger than a watch, obviously, but it just holds the time and date settings usually. But as you can see, that obviously is not correct. Actually, I might as well change it now. And let's check the disk management again. And I should see that partition. Ah, there we go. That's what we should see. So, still have 68% of the hard drive space open. And in terms of what we got here, so we have the normal 1,000 megabytes of recovery partition. This EFI system partition that we have Windows. This is essentially Windows C, so that has 371 gigabytes to work with. And then this is now Ubuntu. So we have 7.92 gigs. That's basically the OS itself, and this 85 is just really space for it to run. But that's the way it should look. So if I go into C, and it tells me I have 254 gigabytes of free space. So if you notice, it doesn't even show the space as being, like, it doesn't show it as 500 gigs anymore, because 100 of that essentially is assigned now to the Ubuntu file system. So even if you added that, that still wouldn't get us to 5, so it would only get us around like 470. So the thing you have to keep in mind is, of course, every drive has over-provisioning factored into it. So even though it's technically rated at 500, the drive itself would have actually been like 512. But then after over-provisioning, it marks it down to 500. And then from there, you have operating system files, things like that, which then takes it down to around like 460, 470 gigs. So, and then in my case, I have another 100 gigs allotted to Ubuntu, so it runs smoothly, and I end up with basically 370 gigs of space to run, which is more than enough for each system to run very successfully. So pretty much I'm going to go ahead and recustomize my Ubuntu setup. But let's say you did want to change systems, you just go in and restart. That's going to blank out, come back on, and then it's going to ask us, hey, where do you want to boot from? And this time we are going to boot through Ubuntu, which basically is already loaded, already here. So as you can see, it does definitely run quicker than Windows. Bam, and I'm on my home screen. So I'll go ahead and get this personalized, but essentially that's how you get your hard drive installed and then get a dual boot. So I have some files to take care of, which is why I have Ubuntu on here in the first place. So I'm going to go ahead and take care of this. But of course, if you have any questions, just drop them down below and I'll do my best to answer them. All right, signing out.